Let's pray. Lord, we ask a blessing on this time as we look at your word and ask that you would cause us to literally hear what the Spirit is saying to each one of us. In Jesus' name, amen. Let me grab my Bible. It's important that I have that. You know, it's been said, I heard this quote and I love this quote. It's been said that time is a great teacher. The problem is, it kills all its students. You see, every 8 seconds, someone dies. And yet every 5 seconds, someone is born. And in between those, in between there, we're here in time. We cannot touch it. We cannot control it. It just seems like we're kind of prisoners in this fourth dimension. And one day, it'll be all gone. And the truth is we're not really here very long. And we only get one chance at all of this. Philippians chapter 1. Verse 3 and 4 and 5 has been our focus the last couple weeks. And the part we focused on last week was part of verse 3, which says, I always pray with joy. I always pray with joy. But prior to that, he says, I thank God every time I remember you in all my prayers for all of you. And then he says, I always pray with joy. And let's read the last part together with us. Because of your, let's say it together. Because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. Partnership. Say that word with me, partnership. He then goes on and says in verse 5, he says that he is confident of this, that he who began a good work in you, that being the Philippian church, which also applies to us, will carry it out to its completion until the day of Christ Jesus. Now, we are going to take a look at that verse next week, but that's the context. This word that is translated partnership, it can be translated several different ways. One of the ways is fellowship, and that is what the translators chose in the King James translation or New King James when it says for he's grateful for their fellowship in the gospel. Other translations will use it more directly, and they'll say, you know, for the help you gave me. And that's really referencing, which did occur, because it's affirmed in other points of this letter in the book of Philippians, the fact that he had received some financial support from the Philippian church while he was in prison in Rome. But it wasn't just about that, because there's much more that permeates in this book than just the fact he's grateful for financial support. And this word that is really coined, a word that is off, you know, if you've been in church for any measure of time, you've heard the Greek word koinonia. And it is a word that is translated as fellowship, partnership, but it also can be translated as participation. And some Bible translations do translate it as participation. And so if I could give in the simplest form a phrase that for today, the word for today would be this: be encouraged to participate. Be encouraged to participate. I want you to turn to someone, if someone's fairly close, and say, be encouraged, participate. Okay? Some of you say, I don't want to participate. Well, then you're not going to like this sermon then, okay? you must forgive me. You may not even see it, but I'm going to put this little mic hook down here because they basically, that's where they cut, and it just hurts when it goes back there. So I'm so sorry that it kind of dangling down there. But in the book of Acts, we have the story of the church, the story of the visible church. if I'd want to say the story of the organized church. You know, whenever the church organizes, people don't like it. First, the world doesn't like it, but then Christians don't like it because usually organization means a set of, you know, rules, a set of, you know, how are we going to relate to each other, how things are going to function, and generally human beings don't like to be told what to do, right? I mean, that's pretty typical. But the visible church is a belief in this church and any other Bible-believing church that the Christians should associate themselves with the visible organized church when possible. Now, there are times where that cannot be possible because the law of the land is against the church and persecutes the church, so they have to meet in secret. And in those settings, that's what they have to do. But we're not in that setting, are we? We have a freedom of worship, and Christians, if they're to grow in the Lord and obey the word, they should gather together on a regular basis with other Christians and worship the Lord and do the things that the early church said were important. Now, early on in the book of Acts, you have that Jesus, of course, came to this earth. He ministered on this earth. He was crucified. He died. He rose from the dead and he ascended into heaven. And then the Holy Spirit was poured out upon the church on the day of Pentecost. Now, the Holy Spirit was already there because the Holy Spirit was breathed into the disciples prior to that. But day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit came upon the church for the purpose of empowering the church for the mission that God had for it. That was the purpose of the baptism or the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. And very quickly, the church defined their values. Very quickly, they defined them. And basically, four things were very important to them early on. And it's Acts 2:42. It says that they, that being the church, the disciples, devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, so that they were taught, to fellowship, koinonia. That's where most common this word is pointed to, is in this verse, to breaking of bread and to prayer. So koinonia is found in the context of Acts chapter 2, verse 42, very quickly, as a value, as a devotion, very quickly. Now, this word koinonia, like I said, can be translated into fellowship, into partnership, into participation. Oftentimes, most people will think of it as fellowship, and when you hear fellowship, they relate it to friendship and companionship, which there's an aspect of that that is very much true. But if that's as far as the definition goes, it's not really the full definition of the word and the way it's used in the totality of the New Testament. In other words, it's a very, you know, one-dimensional view of what this word is communicating, both in Philippians and even, I believe, even in the book of Acts. It really has to do with becoming a part of through participation. Becoming a part of through participation. And I know, before I go any further, I want to tell you what I'm not saying. Because it's important to say that, because usually a sermon like this, as I get into the weeds, someone will go away, well, did he mean this? And hopefully what you're hearing, something in this will bear witness in your spirit and you'll take hold and ownership as a word from the Lord. But what I'm not saying is that the things that I'm going to talk about is intended, nor should it be received as a human yoke of expectation. Okay? That is not what I'm talking about. But I am going to speak the truth. Okay? But each one of us are at a different place in our life. We're not all, circumstances are all the same. And you need to let the Holy Spirit draw you to the place of participation for this season of your life at this moment. You know, it was probably been a decade ago, there was someone that was a part of our congregation that came to me, and they said, you know, Pastor, I just, I just don't feel like I'm doing enough. And first of all, this person, I would not have said that. First of all, when someone comes to your office, pastor's office, and says, "Pastor, I'm not doing enough," I'm usually a positive meeting from that point on. You know, it's not all meetings are that way, but that one is one of those you go, "Oh, this is, you know, thank you," you know. But I said, "Well, what are you doing?" And he started sharing the things that he does, family responsibilities, this, that. And he said, "Well, every week I go and visit people that are dying." And I went, "Really?" And I'm thinking, "Wow, that's amazing." And I said to him, I said, "You know, I want you to know something. I don't want you to feel like you need to do more unless the Holy Spirit is telling you to do more. And you're not getting that from me. But what you're doing, yeah, it's not on any list. It's not on any program. It's not on any organized ministry. But I'm telling you, what you're doing is kingdom of God. And you're doing exactly what the Lord wants you to do, even though no one sees it, but the Lord sees it. And that's enough." And so each one of us needs to figure out what, between the Lord, what am I supposed to be doing? And what is going to and what does it take to motivate me? What am I supposed, you know, some of us, you know, you work 6 days a week, 60 hours a week. And you come to church on Sunday because it's your Sabbath, and you come and you just want to, you want to sing. You don't necessarily have a lot of physical energy, but you just, your soul is being fed through worship and the word. But you really don't have any other margins. You know what? That's okay. This is the season that you're in right now. Do that. Come here on Sunday morning, be fed, be filled, and be Jesus in the marketplace. That's your, you know, that's your role right now, you know? So keep it up and keep going. Don't be discouraged. But in that context, there are others that have more margin. And you're not sure what to be doing or whether you want to participate. I'm here to tell you to be encouraged to participate first and foremost in church life. What I call church life, the life of the church. And Sunday morning, what we are experiencing right now, 11:15 service, thank you for coming. Okay. I'm actually, when I look across the room, I'm not looking at you, I'm actually looking at the empty seats, believing the Lord's going to put people in those empty seats, okay? Okay. And, you know, the 9:30 and the 8:15, the Sunday morning worship services. It really is our entry point, and it's our baseline of church life. I mean, it's the main event of the week, okay? And really coming together at least once a week is really important. It's important to give honor to God collectively together, and that we're not to get in the habit of not meeting with each other, as the book of Hebrews says, some are in the habit of doing. You know, you've heard it said, some people, "Well, I don't have to go to church to be a Christian." Well, that may be true, but I can tell you what's also true. You will not grow in your spiritual maturity in life unless you do regularly gather together with believers to worship and honor the Lord together and learn together. That won't happen unless you gather. And so the encouragement is that people have to want to participate. They have to want to come. And you can't make people come. You can't obligate them to come. They have to want to come. And so my always encouragement to you is, if you struggle at all at coming, gathering together weekly, it's not too much different than maybe with a marriage. There are times and seasons where you're married, if you for any length of time, you go, "Well, I love her, but I don't quite like her right now." Or it could be, "I love him, but don't quite like him right now." Okay, you know, that kind of dimension. It does happen, right? be honest, marriages have great years and down years, and I'm having a great year this year, but this, you know, there's years that are better than others. But one thing the Lord taught me long ago was in the down years, that maybe if a season where I'm not feeling that feeling, I need to go and ask, Lord, cause my heart to be towards my wife. Change my heart so I not just love her out of obligation, but I want to love her. Change my heart to love her as she is. And by the way, he always answers that. Always. And I would encourage you, husbands, wives, to pray that way if you reach that point. But in addition, it's also true with gathering together. If you feel that begin to wane, you start asking the Lord, Lord, will you cause my heart to want to gather? Like, would you change my heart? And you'd be quite amazed at what happens, what the Lord will do. Now, each of us is in a different place. We're all a different place. And so it's just, you know, when we're talking about participating in church life, it's not going to be all the same. But each one of us has to decide in our heart with the Lord, what is this season of my life? What am I supposed to be doing? And then do that. Now, at the beginning of the year, the church elders had asked me to give a kind of a state of the church, and I kind of had a little fun with it the first 2 weeks. You know, kind of did the flourish, you know, da, 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 you know, and then I got up and did my spiel and then moved on. And I was supposed to do the other one last week, you know, if the surgeons didn't hit the bullseye, so I had to redo my surgery. So I was out of commission last week. And so I wasn't able to. But as I looked at it, I realized, okay, I'm not going to do the stand up and do the, you know, little show thing that we did the first 2 weeks, because the third one really has everything to do with this sermon. And the title of the third report was Learning to Belong. Learning to Belong. And, you know, in the back at the Welcome Center, there is the third report that I'll give some of the information here back there. Usually we had them in the inserts before, but they're not this one. But that's back there. And you know, of all three of the reports, and by the way, someone say, you know, State of the Church also involves financial reports. Well, that's given at the annual meeting at the end of the month on the Sunday night at 6 o'clock. And I'm not gonna address that on Sunday morning, that's for that meeting. But of any area dealing with how the church is doing, there really is, when you talking about people learning to belong or becoming part of church life, it's a very difficult thing, because it really takes two. It really takes more than two, but it takes the person wanting to participate, and then it takes the organized church figuring out how to help them participate. And I'm going to be very truthful here with you. We, you know, and this is not a dig on anyone. This has been kind of like my thorn in my flesh for like the last several years. You know, how can I make this work better? Because one person can't just do it. How do you create a system where help people connect, and is it working? I'll just be very honest with you. I'm not the only one. I gather with pastors all the time, and this issue is the number one difficult issue for every church that I talk to. How to help people integrate into a congregation. How to help them. Some people are, their personality types, it's easy for them, because they're just, either one, they're really patient and overlook being overlooked, and they're just able just to get in the mix, or two, they're not that personality, and they are overlooked, and then it just becomes, how do I fit, and it's not working. We don't do a great job of that. I'm just being honest. I'm being very upfront with you, okay? But that doesn't mean, that's not an excuse to say that we are going to try to do better this year, because you never give up trying to improve, right? So when I talk about this, I talk it from the context that we don't do a great job at this, but we're going to do a better job at this. That's my commitment. If I had to, what's the number one thing that's important to Pastor Mike this year and for the church? I'm talking about it right now. Okay? And it's an intentional process of helping people become part of Kingsway. There's the introduction to church life, which I think we've kind of got obviously established. That's the Sunday morning services. And I really wanted a place that was visible that people could come and be welcomed, okay? That if they were interested in connecting, that there would be a place. And so we created the Welcome Center booth back there. That's the reason that exists, so that there's at least one place someone can go and they could get a gift, okay? And they can turn in their connection card, which is what this is. That there would be one central place that visible someone could go to. I'm looking back there right now and realizing all the gift bags that were out there this morning are all gone. That's pretty cool, okay? And the truth is that last year we received 40 of these cards, okay? Now, I like to say that we hit a home run and sent a letter to every single one and got a call to every single one, but the truth is that's not true. And thus, we need to get a lot better at that. And so if you were overlooked and you're still here, wow, what a miracle, okay? We love you. Thank you for forgiving us, and I'm hoping we get a lot better this year on that. So there were 40 connection cards that were turned in last year, and there were 35 next, what we call what's next packets. These are packets that people make a decision to follow Christ, and we want to give them a packet, a Bible, what to do, things, steps to take. 35 of those were taken from our Welcome Center last year. And then there were those gift bags. 156 bags were given out last year. 156 people said, "I'm a guest here at Kingsway," and took one of those bags. By the way, we don't make those available on Easter because, you know, we clear those all out. I mean, we don't usually have the Welcome Center up during Easter time. But the point is that that's 156 people said, "Hey, I'm a guest, and I'll receive a gift from you." And this engaging church life is that initial step is a Sunday morning. This is the people invite people, they come. And then there's the Welcome Center. But then there's not just introduction to church life, there's engaging church life. And this is where the challenge comes. How do you connect people who want to be connected to the church? Now, some people want to be connected in a manner that is the way they want to connect. We may or may not have what they want. And so, you know, that doesn't always work. But to the measure that we have or can create, we need to try to create that or what we have in place. And that is smaller settings to which people can engage church life. And those areas are very clear. In our spiritual development center, we have our Operation Solid Lives class, which we just had a class that just graduated just last service. How many people were in that class? 9 or 10? Okay. You're an engineer, Mike. You should be able to count, man. I can see it. Are they here? Are they in this service? Who are Operation Solid Lives Level 1 graduates from this? Stand up, please. You stand up. Awesome. Great job. Okay, so there's 6. It wasn't 9. No, I'm just kidding. So it's the smaller settings. And there's a home. So by the way, that's Mike and Sue Shirky, our spiritual development directors. But we have home fellowships. And I've talked about this throughout the last couple weeks. And Mitch Johnson, who's raises his hand, oversees our home fellowships. And then there's specialized ministries. Children's ministry, youth ministry, ministry to men, ministry to women. And those are specialized areas that, you know, really fall under the vision of connecting people to Jesus. Now, on the back table back there is a list of those specialized ministries in church life on the Welcome Center, this yellow sheet. It's back there. And there's a list. And next to each description is, if there's a necessary, a contact person. So if it's home fellowships, you're going to have Mitch's contact information. So this is a contact point for specialized areas of ministry. Okay, so it's helping people, connect and engage in smaller settings, which are our discipleship, home fellowship, and specialized ministries. And then there's points of service. And I think oftentimes people engage church life first time when they want to engage beyond just introductory and the Sunday morning in purpose. And I often say relationship often occurs through purpose. And we see that through our missions teams, through our work parties, through our camp programs, where people step in to help and they suddenly develop friendships and relationships, and they're engaging in church life through those means. So then there's introduction to church life, there's engaging church life, and then there's committing to church life. And this one is makes us feel a little uncomfortable. Because anytime you say commit, it's one of those that, you just don't want to hear it sometimes. Well, the truth is we all need to commit to some measure. And what season are you in right now will determine what step you will take next. Now, one of the first areas of commitment to church life is when, strange as it sounds, when someone gives us their email address. So suddenly they want to commit to hearing what's going on. Last year we sent over 40 all church emails. And some people unsubscribe when for whatever reason, but we have over 290 email addresses for our church. And if you are on that list and you are, what's going on? Why aren't they communicating? I can't help you move that mouse over and click. I can't help you with that part. But so maybe you need to read the emails. But maybe you're not on our email list and you don't receive. Well, then you can just simply fill out a connection card and simply just say, put me on your email list. Okay? And on occasion, I don't know if you know this, but the great internet in the sky is not omnipotent, omniscient, nor is it perfect. Sometimes emails go into the digital domain of which none of us know where they go. That doesn't usually happen, but sometimes it does. Usually it's called the dungeon of spam. Okay? And it may not be in your thing. It may be in organization you're using. The point is it's not a perfect mechanism. And sometimes it doesn't always work, but most of the time it does. So if you want that, you need to communicate to us that you want to be on it. And then actually, if you're interested, read it. The next one really is oftentimes the most challenging for some, and that is when a measure of commitment to the church comes when they begin to honor the Lord with the first fruits in the place they're receiving ministry. And what I'm saying is when a person or a family decides to begin to tithe 10% of their income to the Lord at the place to which they call church home. That's a major step of commitment. It's the last thing that usually shows up in commitment, one of the last, and it's the first to leave. And the truth is it has everything to do with faith and trust. Faith that I'm supposed to be doing this, faith that that not only should I, but the blessing that can come from that, but also the trust that it's going to the right place. That's a journey for everyone. And we do our best to try to help with that. But the truth is all of us must come to that place. We believe fully that a person that grows in the maturity in the Lord will learn to tithe to the Lord in the place that they call church home. We believe that. And it's a gift to the Lord, and I don't put conditions on it. It's a gift to the Lord. And the truth is that when we do that, there is blessing that follows with that. You know, our salvation, God, he gives us and says, freely receive. Just believe. Believe and receive. Pretty much everything else in the Bible that says, you know, promise, usually the previous verse is, do this and this will happen. There's the salvation of the Lord is unconditional. The promises of God are conditional. They are acts of obedience done in faith that result in the fulfillment of the promises of God. And when we tithe, he promises us to take care of us more than just in the paycheck. He talks about, I think it has everything to do with our physical health, and it has everything to do with the provision of things that end up costing us money that we don't see a financial benefit. They just don't break down. And thus they don't cost me money that would have cost me money. And you can't quantify that because it didn't happen. That kind of blessing is real. And it is a release that comes from the Lord. And it's, I got to tell you, the discovery of that is an amazing moment. The moment you realize that Malachi chapter 3 is not about the law of the Old Testament, but it predates the law. Matter of fact, when I say I believe what this says and I'm going to do it in faith and I trust the place that I'm putting in, so I'm going to put it here, this is the place I'm at, there is a release that happens that is just amazing. The difficulty is when people don't step into that and they make their own theological decisions, they marginalize that command and they come up with reasons why it shouldn't be that. They don't realize that they are falling into the trap of the second sin of man that was listed. The first sin was they ate from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. The second sin that was recorded was Cain. And the sin wasn't, the third sin was murder when he killed his, but the second sin was this: I'm going to give the way I want to give. Not the way God wanted him to give. That was the second sin. And nothing's changed, by the way. Everybody wants to know everything and everybody wants to do it the way they want. It's been that way from the beginning. It hasn't changed. And the challenge is that sin is crouching at your door. Just like he said to Cain, you need to become its master. The good news is we got the Holy Spirit to help us with that now. And so if you struggle with this, you need to say, Lord, help me with this. Help change my heart. Help me have faith in this. I'm here to tell you that I'm not speaking this from a position of weakness financially with Kingsway. I am absolutely amazed year after year at the generosity of the Lord through the hands of faithful givers in this church. And I'm so grateful for it. And we need to do what we can do to be right and honoring of those sacrificial gifts before the Lord. So that said, we have 238 giving units is the best way to describe it. In other words, it could be families, individuals that consistently give each week here. 238. I'm grateful, and I speak a blessing over every single family person that does that in faith, that the measure of Malachi chapter 3, as they have stepped in obedience, be overflowing in their life, in health, in peace, in joy, in the kingdom of God, to great measure in relationships, into resources, to enjoyment of life, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Now, you would think that giving would be the hardest part of commitment. It actually isn't. Do you know what the hardest one is? Membership. Because I'll have people who have been part of Kingsway for years, they serve, they attend regularly, they give regularly, but they're not members. Now, sometimes they think people confuse the fact that regular attendance and giving finances makes you a member. It actually doesn't. It means you're a part of Kingsway, which we're glad you're here. And whether you're a member or formally a member or not, we serve people regardless, okay? The difference is membership, as we would call it, is really a declaration that I am committed to this church and that it is a way for the church, pastors, to know who we are truly responsible for, to before the Lord. I mean, we're going to help. I'll help anybody who walks off the street. But who am I truly accountable for before God? It's those who say we are members of this church. That's who I am truly accountable to God for. Very important. Very important. And as a Christian, the moment I accept Jesus Christ as Lord, his Holy Spirit takes up residence in my soul. I'm born again. I'm immediately a member of the church body, of Christ's body. But church membership, as I'm describing it, is a declaration that I am a member here. And that's an important thing. Now, there's been people in the past that they show up, this happened, I don't know, probably 15 years ago. Someone I appreciated very much so came to me and said, I'm here to serve, do whatever, but I will not become a member. I'm like, oh, great. I'm glad you're here. A couple years later, they became members. And that has happened more than one time. And it's because when people say that, they're really not saying that to me. Because whether you become a member or not, I will still go to sleep at night. Okay? I will still take my vacations. I will still get paid. Okay? I will still stand up here and preach. It is not a determining factor of what I do. So when someone says they will become a member or not, has nothing to do with me in that regards to what they're deciding. It has everything to what they're deciding between them and the Lord. Okay? And so that's between you and the Lord. And you need to resolve that. Now, it's interesting that over we've grown significantly in the last 20 years. I mean, we had services of 50, 60 people when I first got here. Now there's, on average, we're over 400. But our membership role has pretty much stayed the same over those years. There's 118 people that are members of Kingsway. And now here's my news for you. If you are, as I'm saying this, you're thinking, why am I not a member? I should become a member. Or maybe I should become a member. Or I should pray about becoming a member. If that's any of you, I have made this really easy, okay? You don't even have to get out of the chair in your living room. You could sit in your living room with your computer right there, and you could go online, and you go to our website, and you go to the media area, and you click on that, and another click to media resources, and you will find a membership class 1 and 2. They're about 45 minutes long. And you click one, and it'll take you to their YouTube channel, to that specific class, and you just watch it. And you watch the second one. And then after that, you come to the Welcome Center, and you pick up a little card like this, and it's a blue card, and you fill it out, and that's it. I can't make it any easier than that, okay? So there you go. Do with that what you wish. So koinonia is relationship with each other. It is participation in the church life, but it's much more than that. And this word koinonia is used in the book of Philippians in chapter 2, as it is used here in chapter 1. And it's used in an expanded role. But it's also used in 1 Corinthians chapter, 1 and 2 Corinthians, but in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 9, it's used in a deeper way when it says this: God, who has called you into koinonia, fellowship, with the Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, is faithful. So you have here the essence of koinonia in Acts has to do as participation with the church life. But here, which really precedes that, you have this participation in the Lord in your life. And that is predominantly through the Holy Spirit. So we're encouraged to participate in the Holy Spirit and what he's doing in your life. And this koinonia is about letting the kingdom of God grow in your soul. Letting it grow. And we have this koinonia with each other stemming from koinonia with Jesus Christ through his Holy Spirit. And it is the Holy Spirit that helps us. It's where our faith starts and where it grows from. And without this relationship, this koinonia of the Holy Spirit, church is just a show. I know there are people that come at times will come to a church service, and they may even come for a long time. But if they don't have koinonia with Jesus, it won't last. It won't last. There'll be a reason to reject something, and they'll begin to follow the things that they want to follow for their own sake and do the things that they want to do, and they'll bring complete justification to it. I've watched it over the years. And it's because either A, they have rejected koinonia with Jesus, or they never had koinonia with Jesus. And they just were sitting and acted really good, like a good Christian, but never really had or rejected that koinonia with the Lord. And, you know, I can't make that person do anything. None of us can. And the truth is that growth is limited without that koinonia of the Holy Spirit. It's really where our motivation comes from. It's really where I choose to participate further or take steps of faith, of the very things I just spoke about. It's where that comes from. What motivates you? Where does that motivation come from? How many ever heard of Coach Jimmy V or Coach Jimmy Valvona? How many? Raise your hand. Anybody? Like three people. Four. Five. Great. There was only three in the last service. There was twice as many people. Coach Jimmy V was, I graduated in 1983 from high school, okay? And then I used to watch NCAA play, their playoffs, you know, and the national championship. The 1983 national championship for the NCAA basketball was North Carolina State. And that was an amazing, and to this day is considered one of the greatest, tournament runs in the history of NCAA basketball. And it was coached by Coach Jimmy V. And it was a memorable. They had won like seven games in a row in the last two or three seconds, leading to the national championship, and so much so that they were called the Cardiac Pack, or the Cardiac Kids. This was another one, because they like gave everybody a heart attack at the end of the game. You know, were they gonna win or not? You know, and as a matter of fact, that they beat teams that had like, you know, Hall of Fame legends like Michael Jordan and Clyde Drexler and Kareem Olajuwon from who was on Houston, and the Houston team that was coming into the national title, they were like on a 27-game winning streak. The Phi Slamma Jamma was there. Was some of you don't even know what I'm talking about. Jeez. Anyways, they dunked all their shots. You know, they were just awesome to watch. It was fun to watch them. And in comes this NC State, and cardiac kids, and sure enough, the ending of that final one was the most memorable of college basketball history. Mitch, do you remember that? It was some at the buzzer. Lonzo Charles literally dunked it on a. It was an air ball. That's right, air ball from Derek Wittenberg. Anyways, he slammed last second, and the game's over, and they win, you know. And Coach Jimmy V had prepared his team to cut down the net. He practiced it every practice. They would go and cut down the net all year in preparation for that. They would cut down the net, and he ended up dying in 1993 from cancer. And he gave an amazing speech at the ESPYs award ceremony that was very famous. But prior to that, he gave a speech as a motivational speaker. And in this speech, he spoke about what had started his motivation, what got him to start being motivated to be enthusiastic. And I want you to watch that speech because he really talks about what started it. And it's very, very important. Why don't you watch this?
Now I want to talk to you about how I do my job. I have like 6 minutes left. How I do my job in a competitive field. How each day I try to beat the Notre Dames, North Carolinas, and everybody else. How am I going to do that? All right? I think everybody has to have a personal philosophy of how you live your life. All right, here's mine, very simply put. You plus motivation equals success. I have that only thing in my locker room. Nothing else in my locker room but that sign. You plus motivation equals success. I have it on cards, bookmarks. I have it on everything. It drives me. It's a passion. I was 16 years old. I heard the Reverend Bob Richards speak. Remember him, the Wheaties guy, the decathlon pole vault champion Olympics? And this is what he said, right? The gentleman said it before, but this is what, I was 16. Bob Richards looked over a group of these young kids at a basketball camp and said, the Lord must have loved ordinary people because he made so many of us. And here I am, 16, thinking I'm special. Here's a man I respect. Said, the Lord must have loved ordinary people. He made so many of us. And I was a little, you get a little mad at 16 when someone's telling you. And then he said the line that changed my life at 16 that I felt then. I'm 41 years old. I've been working 21 years in my business. Feel it the same way today. He said, every single day, in every walk of life, ordinary people do extraordinary things. Ordinary people accomplish extraordinary things. And I raised my hand. I'm applying for the job right now. I'm an ordinary guy. I want to do extraordinary things in my life. And I believe it. And I think that's strong. I think that's what it's all about. And I know this group has that same feeling. How do you do that? How do you go from the ordinary to the extraordinary? I think it's the second thing. It's motivation. Motivation to me is three things. Three things each day I try to do to get myself ready to walk. Some people will say to me, how do you motivate 18-year-old kids? How do you motivate yourself? I don't in 21 years motivate anybody except each day one person. I get up, James Thomas Anthony Valvin, and that's a full-time job, keeping me up at the level I want. I hope that if I'm there, my assistants, my players, everyone's, that I, it's a full-time job for me. I'm not a finger pointer. Say, hey, I'm working right, how about you, how come you, no, I work each day to get myself there. How, motivation, number one, enthusiasm. Ralph Waldo Emerson, speaking of graduating class at Harvard, said nothing great has ever been accomplished without enthusiasm. How enthusiastic are you every day? Every day in your profession. I interview people for jobs, and I'm very bad. I'm one of the worst coaches to come and say, what's the benefits here? I don't like it. I've never hired someone who's asking me to go. One fella last year said to me, do you have a dental plan? I said, yeah. If we don't win, the alumni kick our teeth in, you know? I said, that's our dental plan. What is this? You know? That's me. I don't like when people ask me how many weeks off we get before they start to work. That's just me. Maybe I'm wrong, but that's how I am. I know I'm probably not going to change in that regard. I like it. I love what I do. Very fortunate. Right? Enthusiasm. Give yourself an enthusiasm check.
Enthusiasm. But it's interesting where he said it started. It's where it started when someone said to him, God loves ordinary people because he made so many of them. And it's those people that can do extraordinary things. And that's who we are. God made us like everyone else. I'm ordinary. You're ordinary. Okay? The truth is that this whole idea of enthusiasm motivating us. One of the greatest words in the English language is the word enthusiasm. And it's derived from two Greek words, en and theos. And it literally means to be inspired or full of God. To be full of God. When you are full of the Lord, there is an enthusiasm that you want to do. It's not made up. It's not conjured up. It's not chanted up. It is the Lord. It is the Holy Spirit. And it's He who maintains it. It's that idea of koinonia, of the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, that is found in 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 14. And it's what is mirrored in Philippians when he says, may the grace of the Lord Jesus and the love of God and the koinonia, or the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with you all. Paul, after he says this in chapter 1 of Philippians, he then uses the same word in chapter 2 of the book of Philippians when he says this. He says, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, any comfort from his love, any koinonia, fellowship with the Spirit. You see, it's the Holy Spirit that will help you overcome all difficulties, all tragedies, all sorrows, all heartaches. It's koinonia with the Holy Spirit that gives you victory. And it's enthusiasm that makes us exciting about life and creative. It helps a person accomplish things. Experience can make us cautious, but enthusiasm is vital for our spiritual growth. I always say the day, and I've said this for years, and I know a day will come, but it's certainly not now, that when I get in my car on Sunday morning from my house and I make the 2-mile drive to here, if I'm not saying on the way, and I say this when I'm driving every Sunday, Lord, I thank you for the privilege for doing this. I'm excited about coming and sharing the gospel. And you know what? The truth is, I'm just as excited today as I was when 20 years ago when I showed up here and I tried to do it, maybe not as well then, but nonetheless, than 20 years ago. And the moment that's gone is the moment I need to be honest and say it's time for me to be done. The truth is, that's from the Holy Spirit. But we engage it. We welcome it and we engage it. Enthusiasm. Matter of fact, he says fellowship with the Holy Spirit in that chapter 2, which we'll study later on in the year. It says be like-minded, having the same love, having the same purpose, being united. It's that fellowship with the Holy Spirit, being united. And it really leads into being encouraged to participate in church life, the Holy Spirit, and mission. Because in that chapter 2, he says, being like-minded, having the same purpose. And the purpose of why we even exist here at Kingsway is to connect people to Jesus. That is the purpose. It's expressed in many different ways. This word koinonia primarily means participating in something, where oftentimes it is kind of utilized to communicate what we have in common. And that's not the primary use of the word. The primary use of the word is participating in something. And Kingsway, we have a purpose, and that is to connect people to Jesus. Paul says in Philippians chapter 1, verse 3, I thank God, I always pray with joy because of the partnership or participation in the gospel, hear this, from the first day until now. The truth is that he had received a financial gift. He was grateful for their help. But there was much more that was going on here than just that. And it's evidence in that same verse when he says, from the first day until now. In other words, I know that you are concerned about the spread of the gospel in Philippi. He later on is grateful for the gift, but throughout the whole book, he's even more concerned and more grateful that they are committed, they are following, they are participating in the advance of the mission, the kingdom of God, in the place that they're at. The place that they're at. This joy and thanksgiving in the koinonia and the spread of the God, the participation. Paul's singular passion throughout all his books is this enthusiasm for the gospel of Jesus Christ. The gospel was not about his personal story. It was about Jesus Christ. Even in a Roman prison, he was enthusiastic about it. The koinonia, from then until now, from the time that the story started for the Philippine church in the book of Acts to the time that he wrote this from prison, he was appreciative of their partnership in every possible way, that they had stepped into the game. For every word, every deed, every act, everything that they did in faith for the advance of the gospel, he was grateful for. And he was excited. Now, yesterday, I had the privilege of sitting in the Boys and Girls Club watching a basketball game. This little basketball game that on this court, four kids from our church were in that game. Why don't you put that little picture up, would you? Okay? It was fun to watch, okay? Now, one of those kids was my kids. Now, the other kids was Blake Marshall and Elijah and Andrew Brown. I think the Browns are out there. There's mom and dad. I'm sorry our team beat your team. Sorry, you know, but not really, but it was fun to watch. But, you know, as a parent, you're like, I'm like dad, I'm like at the edge of my seat, you know, and I'm wanting to say, you know, and I keep my mouth shut. One time I said, Tim, pass the ball. And he stopped what he's doing and he turned and looked at me. I said, don't look at me. Look at, you know, and that's when I realized, keep my mouth shut, you know, but watching your kid make a basket, you know, you're just, as a father, you're just excited that your kid is participating in the game, right? How many of you have that feeling, watching their kid? It's a wonderful feeling, isn't it? That's exactly how the Father in heaven looks at us. When we step into the game, when we participate. That's what it means when, in the book of Hebrews, when it says this, do not forget to do good and to koinonia with others. For such sacrifice, God is pleased. He loves it when we step into the game. He is pleased when we participate. And so my encouragement to you is participate. Some measure. You know, each one of us has to kind of figure that out. That's the word today. So let's pray. Lord, I want to thank you for your word and all the things that were spoken here, Lord. I believe that you'd asked me to bring forth. I ask that you would help each person in this room discern what the Holy Spirit is saying to them. What measure of this is to be a part of their life and to help them in the next journey of growing in you step by step, that spiritual journey that you have them on. What's next? What next to participate? I speak a blessing on every person. May you cause it to grow and thrive. Just hear this. I'm supposed to say this, that the truth is that you will grow in greater measure as you share your faith in this manner. That you have a greater understanding as you step into this realm than about every good thing that Christ has for you. You won't just receive, you're going to understand, which is even greater than receiving. So Lord, we give thanks and I speak that blessing in the name of Jesus.